Hey guys, I am an educator at an academy learning platform, and there I have started making videos which are totally dedicated for CSIR NET preparation. So if you are preparing for the exam, I'll recommend you to watch my videos over there. I'll be solving previous year questions, I'll be giving you tips and tricks and many more interesting stuffs which you will get over there. So all you have to do is install this an academy learning app, and you have to search for my name, that is Nurul Huda, in the search bar. All right. And you can also click on the link given in the description. From there you can directly go to my profile. All right, and for now let's continue with our topic.
Hello everyone and welcome to the channel. So today in this video we'll be talking about inert and labile complexes. Now I have taken this topic to make you people understand, because I have got many requests from you guys to make video on outer and inner sphere complexes. Now, in order to understand that outer and inner sphere complexes, this is like outer and inner sphere electron transfer mechanism, actually that whole topic name is. So if you want to understand all those things, it's very important to understand about inert and labile complexes, because the terms are always used over there, that inert and labile complexes, like outer sphere outer sphere electron transfer takes place in like so and so inert and labile complexes, somewhat like that. So you should know about inert and labile complexes. So this video is going to be a short video. It won't be going to be a longer one, and like I usually do, but in this video I won't be able to like take questions over here, because like questions from CSIR NET exam, I'll be giving you examples, but I won't be able to take direct question from CSIR NET exam, because there are no direct question which have been asked from here. So this is just a supportive video, just a supportive knowledge, so that by knowing this thing you can like understand the bigger things, like outer and inner sphere electron transfer mechanism. So let's start with the topic. So inert and labile complexes, first of all let's understand that this thing is about the stability of the complexes. So with this, like the inert means that the thing which is not reacting, and the labile means which is prone to react, all right, which means that it can react if the certain condition is given, if a certain if proper things, like proper conditions are provided, it can react, it can undergo reaction. So that is the sole name, sole meaning of it. So inert means it will not react, and labile means it is prone to react. Now the stability of complexes, so basically we have two types of complexes, either they are kinetically stable or they are thermodynamically stable. Kinetically stable means which is stable during a reaction, so that is called kinetically stable. Now thermodynamically stable means if you heat that thing, if you provide heat to that, then it will be like stable or not stable. So that type of stability is called thermodynamically stability, and if you check the stability on the basis of reaction, it is called kinetically stability. All right, so kinetic stability. Now the thermodynamic stability is measured in terms of two terms, that is beta and k. So beta gives your overall rate constant. So if something is broken, some complex is getting reduced into, like if you have ML6 complex, and if you heat it, first it will convert into ML5, then ML4, then ML3, something like that. So beta will be the overall rate constant. Then what is the overall rate constant for the reaction from ML6 to let's say ML2? But K will be your stepwise rate constant. That is, if you are coming from ML6 to ML5, then what is the rate constant in that step? Then ML5 to ML4, then what will be the rate constant over there? So this is called stepwise rate constant. So this term, or this thing, this beta and K term, this you all must have studied. If you have studied inorganic chemistry, if you have taken in your masters, then obviously you people have studied about it. So we are not going to talk about this thing, because inert and labile is the concept which is asked, like which comes under kinetic stability. So a kinetic stability of the complex can be termed into two forms, that is either they can be labile or they can be inert. So if what is this labile means? Labile means that ligands are easily substituted, means it is like easily reactive. So if you have a metal ligand complex, say ML6, it can easily react, and the ligands can be substituted by the other ligands. But what is inert means? Inert means that the ligands are not that easily substitutable. So if you have ML6 complex, you are providing a condition, but it will not substitute and it will not react. The thing which you have to keep in mind over here is that kinetically inert complex does not mean that it will be thermodynamically stable. All right, thermodynamic stability is different thing and kinetic stability is different thing. Okay, so don't confuse between these two things. Sometimes they can ask you that either a kinetically inert complex can be thermodynamically stable, then answer will be no. It can be, but not always. All right. So, and similarly, like a thermodynamically stable complex cannot be inert. So these two things you have to keep separated. Okay. So we'll just talk about the kinetic stability. So labile and inert complexes, let's try to understand it in like about different complexes. All right. So let's first talk about square planar complexes. So we have a square planar complex like this. Now, square planar complex will be always labile. Why? So because the ligands are arranged on the with the metal on a plane, and if you are attacking, like if you want to attack a ligand from outside, it can easily come and it can get attached from either from the upside of the plane or from the downside of the plane. So it is prone to reaction. It can undergo certain substitution, it can undergo addition. So that's why this is labile. All right. So it is not, because it is not sterically crowded. It like the metal is open up from the upside and downside. So it is not sterically crowded. So the next thing is that it is, it favors ligand substitution. Now, why it favors ligand substitution? Because it is not sterically crowded. Ligand, the outer, the other ligand can come from any of the side. All right. So since the metal is open up from the upside and downside, so this all four ligands, they all lie on the plane. So you don't have anything on above the plane and below the plane. So if a ligand can come and join from the upside and one ligand have to leave from here, if these of the ligand have a good leaving ability and they leave, then like you can undergo easily the substitution. So the incoming ligand can easily come here, all right, because it is not sterically crowded. So always remember that square planar complexes are always labile. Okay, so now let's talk about octahedral complexes. Now the octahedral complexes are like, here you see that they are sterically crowded also because metal is covered from all the sides. You have ligand attached to the metal. So these four ligands are on the plane. This one is above the plane and this one is below the plane. So these octahedral complexes can be labile also or they can be inert also. All depends on the electronic configuration and the repulsion caused between metal orbital and ligand. Okay, so we'll discuss that how to identify that whether an octahedral complex will be labile or inert. Okay. All right. So in the beginning, it was explained on by using valence bond theory, VBT. So your valence bond theory, it explained that you can have two types of complexes. They can be either your outer orbital complexes or they could be your inner orbital complexes. Now, what are outer and inner orbital complexes are? So outer orbital complex means the complexes which are formed in which outer orbitals are involved, like they will have a hybridization of sp3d2, whereas inner orbital complexes are those in which the inner d orbital is involved, like they have the configuration of d2 sp3. So both are octahedral complexes, but here what are the different, what is the difference in both of them? Like here your n d orbital, like if you have 4s, 4p and then 4d orbital will be involved in the hybridization, whereas here your 3d, 4s and 4p orbitals will be involved in the hybridization. So this is the difference between outer and inner orbital complexes. We'll take one example and like from both of them and we'll try to understand. So let's take, we have MnCl6. All right, so MnCl6 3-, that means manganese is having 25 electrons and the outer the electronic configuration will be 4s2 3d5. All right, and here the oxidation state of manganese is +3, so that's why Mn+3 will have 4s0 3d4 complex configuration. So if you fill those in the 3d orbital, you will have 4 electrons in like 3d, then your s4s 4p and 4d will be vacant only. Now this chlorine has to form bond. So according to valence bond theory, what will happen? This chlorine will share its pair of electron in 4s. Like these electrons, these cross ones are showing the electrons which are shared by this 6 chlorine. So chlorine are sharing their electrons like this through the coordinate bonds. So you can see that 4s, 4p and 4d orbitals are involved. So that's why this is called outer sphere, outer orbital complex. Whereas here, if you see in the inner orbital complex, you will find that if I take example over here, that is chromium CN6, chromium hexacyanate. So you have 3- over here. So the electronic configuration of chromium is 4s1 3d5. You have chromium plus 3 over here, so 4s0 3d3. So just fill the 3d orbital like this. So this is your 3d orbital, this is your 4s, and this is your 4p. So now cyanide will share its six cyanide will share their pair of electrons. So this will come from cyanide. Okay, so you have this six bond pair electrons shared from the cyanide. So here you can see that the 3d orbital is involved in the hybridization, whereas and all these will form a hybrid orbital to the further things you know according to valence bond theory. But here these will form bond, means hybridization. So here 4d orbital is involved, whereas here 3d orbital is involved. So therefore it is called inner orbital is involved, that's why it is called inner orbital complex. And here outer orbital is involved, that's why it is called outer orbital complex. So the basic difference is that in outer orbital complex your n d orbital are involved, whereas in inner orbital complex your n minus 1 d, means if your outermost shell is 4, then n minus 1, that is 3d orbital is involved. And what are the consequences of it? That since you can see that the outer d orbital is involved, that's why metal and ligand bond will be larger, because you have to form larger bond in order to reach 4d orbital. Okay, from metal. So metal ligand bond will be larger, and a longer bond is a weaker bond. We all know this thing, and its energy will be higher because it's weaker. So that's why its energy will be higher. Whereas in this case, the d orbital is inner one, so you just have to reach up to the third shell in order to form the bond. So that's why the metal ligand bonds are shorter, and they are stronger, and that's why they have lower in energy. Alright, so that's why these complexes are labile, whereas these are inert. So your outer orbital complexes are labile, whereas inner orbital complexes are inert. Why? Because in outer orbital complexes, your outermost d orbital is involved, and that d orbital forms the metal ligand bond becomes longer, weaker, and higher energy. That's why they are more prone to break, and that's why they are labile. Whereas in this case, the metal ligand bonds are shorter, they are stronger, and they are less prone to break. So that's why they are inert. So this was explained according to valence bond theory. Yet there were many exceptional cases, like in this, I'll discuss them here only. Okay, so the exception was seen when they observed, the scientist observed about D6, D7 and D9 configuration. According to valence bond theory, they all should be inert, alright, because they don't have low lying d orbitals, so they all should be inert. But experimentally it was found that they were all labile. So then all these were some exceptions which were not fulfilled by valence bond theory. Now the exceptions were they overcome all these exceptions when they tried to explain it using crystal field theory. So we'll try to understand according to crystal field theory. Alright, so now this crystal field theory, according to the crystal field theory, it said that in octahedral complexes, the d orbital splits up into eg set of orbital and t2g set of orbital. We all know this, and we also know that the eg set of orbital is aligned along axis. Alright, so this is along axis, and this is in between of axis. Okay, so this is in between of axis. So that means then if the ligand is approaching, if the ligand approaches, they approach from EG orbital. They are directly approaching from the EG orbital. So because obviously ligands are on the axis, and all these things I have already discussed in my video on the basics of coordination chemistry. So you can watch that video if you haven't watched that video yet. So yeah, so the ligands are approaching from the axis, and EG orbital is also aligned along the axis. So if electrons are there in the EG orbital, so what will happen? The electrons of the EG orbital and the ligand electrons, the electron in the ligand filled orbitals, they both will repel each other. And due to that repulsion, metal ligand bonds along the axis will increase. So if the bond length increases, it becomes weaker, the bond become weak, and it becomes a labile. So whenever in your in any of the configuration, if there is any electron in your EG orbital, then the complex become labile. All right, and otherwise if it is like only T2G is filled, then it is inert. But in case of your D0, D1 and D2 configuration, you don't have an electron in the d orbital D0, so all the d orbital is empty. So that's why the approaching ligand, the coming ligand, can easily approach towards the metal, like it can easily approach because electrons are not in D0. Similarly, in D1 you just have one electron, and D2 also you just have two electrons. Now in case of D3, what will happen, your T2G orbital will be filled, but there is no electron in EG orbital. Okay, so like the repulsion will be not here. Similarly in D4, low spin complex, your EG is not filled, so there will be no repulsion between the metal orbital and the ligand orbital. But in high spin complex, what will happen, you just have one electron in the EG orbital, so there will be some repulsion. Similarly, it is like all the configuration are over here. So for D5, low spin, it is inert because there is no repulsion, whereas high spin one is labile because you have two electrons in the EG orbital. Similarly for D6, low spin, it's inert because there is no electron in EG orbital. In high spin, it has three electrons, so there will be repulsion, so that's why it is labile. And all these configuration like D7, D8, D9, D10, everywhere if you feel it in either in your low spin or high spin, there will be electron in EG orbital, so that's why it is labile. So that's all for this video. I tried to make you people understand about inert and labile complexes. And it was very important for me to make this video before outer spin and outer sphere electron transfer mechanism and inner sphere electron transfer mechanism. So I'll be making next video on outer and inner sphere electron transfer mechanism. That's all for this video. Thank you for watching. I hope you people like this video. And if you haven't subscribed the channel, please subscribe. Thank you for watching.